We will, the funeral for Miss Maggie will be tomorrow morning from 11 to 12, visitation from 10 to 11. Funeral will be from 11 to 12. They'll bury Miss Maggie at Rest Haven. We will, I think I may need some help, Jimmy and Carson and Bryson and Cole. We'll get these altars moved to the hallway in here after church. Probably need to set up a few tables too. I'm not sure how many in their family will be here tomorrow. We are going to feed the family after the funeral tomorrow.
She said there's about 30.
About 30.
In the family.
Okay. So about 10 tables or so. Just remember that. I think Sister Phyllis and them are headed back today from Arkansas. Went up and they one of Pastor's friends had passed away last week. And he's been in our church several times. Becky and his daughter were good friends, so they're traveling back today. So remember them in their travel and mercies. So, other than that, let's just pray. Father God, we just love you, Jesus. We thank you for your blessings. Pray that you'll be with us tonight as we study your word, Father. Continue to grow spiritually, Father. Pray that your Holy Spirit just move in our hearts and lives tonight. Touch those who aren't able to be here tonight as well. Father, we bring a special request to you tonight as we get ready to lay Sister Maggie to rest tomorrow. Father, I just pray that you be with that family. Touch that entire family. Wrap your arms around them. Guide them through this. Give them peace that they can't even understand, Father. Touch Sister Phyllis and them as they begin to travel back today, Father. Be with them as they also have lost a friend, a loved one. Lord, all of us in this community have been touched one way or another. And we thank you for that peace that only you can give, Father, knowing that one day we will have greater hope than seeing you and seeing our loved ones again. Father, bless us tonight. Sister Candace comes and shares her heart with her. Bless her. Let her speak that you would have her speak, Father. Let us be open and ready and attentive to apply your word to our lives, Father. Bless us as we continue in worship. Bless the praise and worship team as they open up to you, Father, and as we move in with you and worship you, Father. I pray, Lord God, that you'll guide us through that and allow us to get our mind and heart right to hear your word. We love you, Jesus. Your precious name we pray. Amen. Thank y'all. Stand with us.
Trusting in God and living in His way is the only firm foundation that we should be standing upon. I know lots of times in our lives we turn around and we encourage other people and let them know, you know, God's in control. God's in control. How many times do we say that to each other? But how many times do we actually think about what we're actually saying? Because sometimes when it happens in our own life, it doesn't feel like it. I don't know about you, but I know that's the way I feel sometimes. I encourage lots of people, let them know, you know, God's peace is there, God's in control. But then when I actually sit back and I take my needs to God, it's hard for me to stand upon that rock, even though I know He's a steady rock. But it's difficult, especially when you got waves crashing over your head. So I'm here tonight to remind you that God is in control. And we don't have to let our faith waver. We can stand upon that promise. Isaiah 26, verses 3 and 4 says, "You will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is steadfast because he trusts in you." Trust in the Lord forever, for the Lord himself, is the rock eternal. We can't give up encouraging each other. God is in control. Look at your neighbor and tell him, God is in control. He is. And it's okay to express our dependence upon him because we do need him. In every circumstance in our life, we need him. So I'm here tonight to remind you, God is in control. Amen. And if you believe that, It should be easy to lift your hand tonight and bow before the God of all creation and let him know, Lord, I need you. I need you in every thought and aspect of my life. We thank you, Jesus. And we praise you, Lord God. You are a great and awesome Lord. And we worship you. Worthy.
that are spoken and turn them back on ourselves so we can be more focused on you. God, as we go throughout our week, Monday, Tuesday, back here again on Wednesday, let us be focused on you. When we come into the Wednesday night service, Lord, and the message is spoken, then let that message make us focus even more on you. Called a connect question, where I ask the children to find someone in the room. They always have a challenge. It might be someone who's wearing the same color or has the same birthday month or is the same age, okay? And I tell them, you have to ask, find someone who fits the description, and you have to ask them this question. And so sometimes it pertains to the lesson. Sometimes, like tonight, it doesn't directly pertain to the lesson. So I'm going to ask you guys a connect question. If you feel comfortable, I want you to swap sides. That's what we call it in children's church. So what I want you to do is, if you're on this side, or since this side is a little more full than this side, you guys can mingle a little bit together if you have to. I want you to find somebody on the other side and ask them this question. In as few words as possible, how can I pray for you this week? Okay? Ready, set, go. Some of y'all are not moving. And some of you young ones should be ashamed of yourselves, because y'all are making the older people get up and move when you should be moving to them. Some of you have long prayer requests, so sum it up. Okay, I sometimes have to do this in children's church too. All right, guys, take a couple more minutes. Wave to a few more people. Make your way back to your seats. In case you wonder what children's church is like, I put a few little tidbits in every sermon I give y'all, so maybe you know. One week, I'll tell this has nothing to do with my sermon, but it was so cute. One week we were doing a connect question, and the connect question started out with, find someone with your same birthday month, okay? Which is a bit of a challenge for a K-4 kid, right? So I had one little kid. I had Lenny in there, and she was looking around like lost as can be. And halfway through, Jax goes, Miss Candace. He says, Lenny has not answered a question for nobody. And I said, well, that's okay. You know, the grown-ups, we are neutral. We don't have birthday months in this particular game. So if you don't have a kid to match with, you get to ask one of the grown-ups. And he goes, no, that's not the problem. And I said, well, then what is the problem, Jax? He said, she doesn't know when she was born, and I don't either. So sometimes it can be a little bit confusing. This morning, I was saying God is not confusing, but sometimes us adults are in the directions we give. Today, I want you to turn to 1 Kings 15, 19. Or 9 through 15. 1 Kings 15, 9 through 15. And this is the story of an Old Testament king, okay? I love the book of Kings and Chronicles. They're so interesting. I don't know if you've noticed, but I really like history. And these are history books, so these are really good. We're going to start in verse 9 because that is where the story of Asa starts. And that's who we're going to be talking about today. It says, and in the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah. And 41 years reigned he in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Maacah, and the daughter of Abishalom. And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. And he took away the Sodomites out of the land, and removed all the idols that his father had made. And also Maacah his mother, even her, he removed from being queen, because she had made an idol in a grove. And Asa destroyed her idol, and burnt it by the brook Kidron. And the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. And he brought in the things which his father had dedicated, and the things which himself had dedicated, into the house of the Lord, silver and gold and vessels. So Asa is one in a long lines of the kings of Judah. Okay, so he wasn't a king of Israel. At this point, the nation was divided into Judah and Israel, and he was a king of Judah. And he was one of the ones that he saw good and he saw evil, right? He looked to his past and he said, I've seen some good kings. David, Grandpa David, right? He was a good guy. He served the Lord. He followed God. He sought the commandments and did what was right. But he'd also seen evil. Asa's dad, Abijam, was an evil king. In this time, you kind of went in one kind of case or the other, right? You were part of one or the other. You either seemed to be a king who, like Asa, followed in the path of David and was a good guy, or you followed in Abijam, his father, who said walked in the sins of his father, okay? And when it says father there, it doesn't necessarily mean the dad before him, but it means forefathers in his past. So you kind of fell into one or the other. You either walked like King David in the ways of God, or you walked like some of the fathers who walked in their own way and in their own desires. Now, the story of Asa is so beautiful because when he took the throne, he had been living as a young man under the reign of a king who was evil. And he'd seen all these statues built up. And he said, that's not right. I don't like that. That's not what the Bible says to do. And so he physically tore them down. And I think that's a beautiful imagery because now it's very seldom, not to say it doesn't happen, but it's very seldom that we are delivered from an idol and we get to literally tear it out of our house, right? There's a beautiful imagery we see here. Because here we see Asa goes into the places where they were worshiping idols and he literally tears them down. And he cleans them out and he takes them away. He gets rid of the idols. It's beautiful. The Old Testament is full of these types of imagery, which shows physical changes that we now experience in a spiritual way. Not to say God won't ask you to tear down some idols, but usually it's an inward thing, right? But with Asa, he had a heart after God, and he literally went and tore down these idols. So this story, if you're wondering where I'm getting some of my facts from, and because sometimes I get excited and forget to tell you what part of the story I'm talking about, the story of Asa does take place in 1 Kings chapter 15. It's a summary. The full-length story is actually three chapters in 2 Chronicles, chapters 14, 15, and 16. And that's where we get the details, right? So if you're wondering while I'm talking, where did she get that? I don't see this in the text. It probably came from Chronicles. Check the story out because it's really, really awesome. But here we have Asa. And he made some very interesting decisions later in life. So I'm not saying, I'm going to preach how you need to be more like King Asa. But I'm not saying he was the epitome of a Christ follower, okay? Because later in life, when he was an older man, he actually made several decisions that were questionable at best. He misused the offerings of the church. And he also came against Israel at one point with another king, and that's a kind of a no-no, okay? So there were a few things Asa did in his late in life that maybe were questionable. So maybe he followed in the path of King David maybe just a little too closely. But the Bible does say very clearly that Asa's heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. Asa had this goal. He wanted to clean out Judah. And a couple of things had to happen. See, through the story of Asa, we learn a lot about the pursuit of holiness. And this was this holy crusade that Asa had started on. His heart was perfect with the Lord all his days. His desire was to create a nation that was pure, holy, and pleasing to God. He watched his father and grandmother allow other religions to take the place of the one true God. And when he became king, he changed that. He said, it's going to be different. We're going to do things differently. I only have one point tonight, and everyone went, oh, thank goodness. But I must warn you, okay? This is a multi-layered point. It's kind of like the onion of spiritual points, okay? So we're just going to keep peeling back the layers. So I don't know that that's going to help us on time, but I do only have one point, if that makes you feel better. And my point is this. We've got to clean out the idols. Asa allowed himself one objective. He had one goal. He did what the other good kings of Judah had to do every time they followed the reign of an evil king of Judah. He was pleasing to the Lord. And to be honest, you know, in the Old Testament, I mentioned you were labeled as a king as one or the other. You were either good or you were evil. And so Asa was trying to be good. Because what he saw was he saw the nation of Judah was kind of a mixed bag, right? They had some good ones, they had some bad ones. They had some good ones, they had some bad ones. They'd have a couple good ones, and then some bad ones would come along and destroy everything the good ones did. And then they'd get some good guys, and they'd build up a great strong nation, and then here would come evil and just kind of seemingly scrape it out. So I imagine Asa comes along, and like many young leaders do, was like, I'm going to fix it. Like, nobody's going to come after my country, and nobody's going to turn it towards evil after I'm done, because I'm going to be that king, right? A few things I found really interesting about Asa, though, is he wasn't really told, you have to do this, this is your job, in some great, big, mighty, prophetic way, right? Think about other biblical prophets. I mentioned Moses this morning, right? His was a flaming bush. That's powerful. That's amazing. That'll change your life. You see that? You better do what God tells you to do. Or I think of Balaam's donkey, right? If an animal of any kind, I don't care what kind it is, speaks to me, I'm going to think one of two. I'm going to think one thing. Let's be honest. I'm going to think I have lost my mind and now I've gone crazy. But if the donkey says, look, there's an angel of the Lord, and I look and there's an angel of the Lord, then I might say, okay, second option, it's of God, right? But after the animal speaks to you, you have no choice. You have to do what God said, right? He has proven himself way too big. If I find a coin in a fish's mouth because Jesus told me it would be there, I'm going to be pretty convinced that I've got to do what God has told me to do. These are great things. Asa doesn't really get that. Here's what happens with Asa, and I'm going to talk a little more about that later. But Asa goes out to battle. He prays a great prayer. We're going to talk about that later too. And then a prophet comes after he's won a battle. He's feeling pretty good. A prophet just comes to him and says, look, Judah has a history of turning against God. But look at Israel. Right now, Israel is living without a God. Do you want to be like Israel? You need to clean out the idols. That's it. How many of us have heard sermons like that in our lifetime, right? Probably most of us pretty often. But that's all it took. Asa was so heart-tuned towards God that he took what the prophet said and he ran with it. And so there's a couple things that stick out to me about Asa. See, Asa, he became king in a really peaceful time for the most part. And he had this, seemed to have this good moral grasp of the Bible. He saw the duty that was set before him, and he knew what he had to do. So he started it, and he started it in his own place, in his own kingdom. He took down the foreign altars and the pagan shrines in his own kingdom. He cut down the Asherah poles. He started with his own house, right? He goes out. Where does he go first? He goes and takes down dad's idols that dad had built. And he goes down and takes the Bible says mother out of a sign of respect. We actually think it was probably his grandmother, okay, which I don't know about you, but I wasn't allowed to touch my grandma's stuff, okay? And so he goes out, and he cuts down her Asherah pole, which was a big symbol of worship in this time to this god, and he cuts it down, and he starts there. Now, he might have done some things wrong, right? If it were me, I would have just burned all the groves and said, nobody can come back here if I destroy where they were worshiping. He didn't do that. He did it a little differently maybe than I would have done or you would have done, but he started out, man, going in and taking down what mom and dad had built. And before your southern heart goes, ooh, I don't like that he was touching mom and daddy's stuff. That's disrespectful. You need to realize something. The point of the story is not necessarily that he was taking down his ancestors' things. It was that he was starting at home, right? Because he said, generations before me dropped the ball. Generations before me have taken and allowed idols to be built up. Generations before me allowed evil in my house. And I can't do that because I'm going to have a son that's going to take the throne. And what will he think if I just let it stay because it belonged to grandma and grandpa or because it belonged to dad? And so he starts at home. He starts in the house. He cleans up himself, and he cleans up his family, and that's where he begins. Have you cleaned out the idols in your own home, in your own life? And I know y'all get tired of hearing me say it. My kids, trust me, get tired of it more. But David said, search my heart, know my thoughts, see if there be any wicked way in me. He didn't say, search Israel. Know Israel's thoughts. See if there's any wickedness in Israel. He said, me, my heart, my thoughts, my desires, search me. He started at home. Asa started at home. He gave back the gifts that his father had set aside for the temple, and I guess just never had the time to take it. He took the gifts he had set aside for the temple, and he took them to where they belonged and gave them to the house of God. Have you cleaned out the idols in your own house? Why? Why is that important? Well, next, he took it to the people. Because Asa looked at the nation of Judah, and he was giving them these instructions. He basically took a step forward, used his platform, and said, Judah, hear me. Turn to God. Seek God. He's your God. He's the one you serve. The same God that King David served, that's who you need to be serving. And so after he cleaned out the idols from his own home, he then turned it to the people. Why in that order? Well, because that's a biblical order to go in, okay? I think if we're not careful, this is everybody, all of us, every one of us, if we're not careful, okay, we'll have a real bad habit of saying, well, there's one thing I know about Little Miss Susie Johnson over here. Now, Little Miss Susie Q Johnson over here, she is not doing what she ought to be doing. I was talking to her the other day in Walmart, and she had a need, hadn't even prayed about it. Now, I don't know about y'all, but little Donnie Lou Who down the road, I saw him outside with some real bad fellas. Now, I don't know what was going on. He said he was witnessing, but I'm just wondering where his heart is. We're really quick to step on someone else's toes, to point out, I think the New Testament says beam and mote. I don't know if that sounds familiar to you. We have a real bad problem about that. I have a bad problem about that. We're humans, right? It's a problem. But this story follows a very clear biblical example of this. Clean out your own house. And once you've cleaned out your own house, then you look out and you say, and this is, we learned this, okay, in a leadership club one time. Thank you to Miss Susan Thompson and the 4-H Center, okay? Everyone has an umbrella of influence. Have you ever heard that before, right? Have you ever been out in the rain and you held up an umbrella? The rain is going to protect what is under that umbrella. Nothing on the outside of the umbrella. If you put your arm out, right, or you try to fit too many people under your umbrella, it's just not going to work. The rain is not going to be protected, or what's underneath is not going to be protected, right? You all have an umbrella. And I remember very vividly from high school them telling us that we only have control over what falls under our umbrella of leadership. Okay? You can influence people, and you can do great things, and that's your job, and that's your goal. But you have no power over those outside your umbrella, right? So this may look as simple as this, okay? Carson, you're sitting so close to the front, I'm going to use you, okay? Carson, you don't have the same umbrella of leadership I have. You have leadership because you got skills, right? You've got certain people at your school, in your family, in your sports that you play, that look to you as a leader. That is your umbrella. You have an impact on those people. But I also have an umbrella, okay? Carson, I'm sorry, but you don't have that much impact on the people under my umbrella because they're my responsibility. Does that make sense? Y'all getting me? Some nods if you understand, okay. And this is what Asa does, right? First, he starts with himself, and he says, I have a job to do. Clean out the idols. Get rid of my own problems, my own sins, my little pets that I keep around because I like them and I don't want to get rid of them. And then he says, now, I'm a king. Now, mind you, Asa's umbrella was pretty big. But he said, I'm a king. So what's next? And he looks out at the people and he says, oh, Judah, do you remember what has happened when we didn't do what we were supposed to do? Judah, you're my umbrella. Clean out the idols. So the people of Judah started to listen. As a matter of fact, they had such an impact. I love this. They had such an impact that a couple of the tribes of Israel, the Bible says in Chronicles, that a couple of the tribes of Israel were like, hey, can we join you guys? Because you actually have a better grasp on God and serving God than our king in Israel does now. And so we're going to actually join you in worship. And they all went together to Jerusalem and they sacrificed a bunch of animals and did a bunch of worship in the way that the Bible in that time that they were needing to do. He took and influenced his umbrella, and his umbrella actually got bigger. That's another sermon for another time. You all have somebody you are in charge of. Husbands, fathers, you've got a pretty big umbrella and a pretty heavy weight on your shoulders because you're impacting an entire next generation in your wives. And that goes for whoever the spiritual leader in your home is, okay? Because for some of us, that may not fit in that, you know, dad is the leader kind of scenario. I understand there are different situations. Do you have an umbrella, okay? If you teach a Sunday school class, you have an umbrella. That's part of your umbrella. Take that seriously. Challenge them after you've checked yourself. Clean out the idols. If you are part of our worship team, you have a pretty big umbrella and a pretty wide influence. What you do up here directly impacts what we do out there. That's a mighty big umbrella. For those who are new, that you're just picking up on this and this is brand new to you, don't take that lightly. Because that's part of your umbrella. Now, for me, my umbrella might be a little... It has expanded a bit in the last bit. In the last 15 years since I was started doing children's ministry, my umbrella now, thanks to social media, they just keep following you, you know, and you don't get to send them off to youth. They're just continuously a part of your life. So my umbrella just keeps getting bigger and bigger with every class of sixth graders I send away, right? My umbrella gets pretty big. Our deacon and our deacons and our board, you have a big umbrella. And you're feeling the weight of that. So here's my challenge to all of you. But it doesn't matter if you're on staff. I called out us because we're easy targets. And I felt like, you know, it would be nicer if I called us out than you, right? But you've all got an umbrella. And Asa looked out and he saw his congregation. And he said, these people, I'm directly responsible for them. It's my job. But he started with himself. And then he told them, clean it out. You know, sometimes we know what to do and we just don't do it. But Asa is a picture of what happens when we know what to do and we do it, right? Isn't that refreshing? He cleaned it out. He cleaned out the idols. He saw this great reign as a king because of it. So what about it, right? What happens? What would happen if we took what we know about God and about God's word and we lived it and we taught it and we passed it on? God showed up and he spoke through one man of God to one king, and that king, as a result, influenced not only his own nation, but some who were in another nation at that time. That's obedience. A lot of times we will find that those around us do not like to hear about cleaning out idols, right? They would prefer you to continue to agree with them and to do the things that they do and the things that you've always done. And cleaning out idols is not a, it's not a clean task. I said it was a beautiful imagery, but in reality it was a mess, right? I don't know how many of you guys have ever taken place in or observed, if you were lucky, a big renovation project, right? I'm talking about like ripping out cabinets or carpet, the kind that ends up with a lot more elbow grease and ripping than you would like, right? You're always taking it out for a reason, right? You're taking out the carpet so you can put in hardwood floors, or you're or refinish the hardwood floors, or you're taking out the cabinets. A lot of times you get into those projects and the taking it out is the hardest part, right? The pre-made little piece you put back in there is pretty easy to do, but it's that ripping it out and tearing it that gets to be the toughest part. So I don't want you to think that just because I said it was the right thing to do, that it's going to be the easy thing to do. Because Asa had to go in and physically remove idols that the people wanted to stay. And it was tough and it was hard. So don't think it's going to be easy. I think it's going to be a lot like, it's going to be a lot like those renovation projects. Hard and difficult, but hopefully worth it in the end. In this case, it definitely will be. He did all that so that the people in his congregation, the people in his nation, could live a life after God. But notice, though, that I did not tell you what idols to get rid of. Because the truth of the matter is, I don't know your battles. But God does. God's aware of what you're facing. You're not hiding it from him. He knows exactly what is going on. And so when you bring it to him, he's going to rejoice in the fact that you brought it to him instead of shaming you for the fact that it was there in the first place. The truth is, the list of idols, it's vast and it's large. Let's just look at the Bible for a second, right? So Judah had literal and physical idols in their nation. David, though, was a slave to lust. Peter was a prince of pride. Judas sold out to greed. Paul preached to churches frequently about idols in their sanctuary, some of which were, they were worshipers of education. One, food consumed their debates. They debated about food. Should we eat it? Should we not eat it? Like, what should we eat? Can we eat it? I'm not really sure. And others would, they were just plain slaves to very typical things like racism and false doctrine. Many disciples, the disciples, 12 guys walking with God, with Jesus every single day, and they would even worship fear, opinions, and traditions. Idols come in many forms, and we all struggle with different things. These are the best among us, right? The guys who walked with Jesus, the ones who saw miracles, and these were their idols? It really makes me wonder, what things do I have that I have not addressed? The Bible's full of examples of people who allowed the idols in their life to control them. And, you know, these may not sound like a normal list of idols you might have consuming you, I feel like most of us, when we think of an idol, we think of something really big, right? One of the seven deadly, and we've got that under control. Or one of the big ten, we walk that line. We follow those directions tightly. We don't ever cross it. We know exactly what we're supposed to do. But sometimes it's the little things that can creep in, the small things. And Asa started from a basis of the word. So he started here. So I want to make it easy on us tonight. Start here. Know the word. If you notice, whenever the prophet came to Asa, he didn't say, Asa, I need you to start reading the Bible. Asa was a king. He'd studied these scriptures better than you and I probably ever could. Start with the word. And, you know, he didn't get up and shout from the hilltop, I have a vision from God. No. He took a step back, and he pinpointed the problem. And then, as any good leader should, he said, okay, let me deal with my problems. Once I've got that under control, let me tell the nation what they need to do. He made sure that he was humble before God in tearing down his idols. And then he just started cleaning house. I'm actually getting ready to finish up tonight. I told y'all it might not be long. One point, you know. I want to go ahead and ask you guys something, okay? Something a little different. Tonight, instead of me giving an altar call and you really responding, I just want to let you all know that we're all just going to pray, so just be prepared. It's a good thing it's short, because I'm just going to challenge you guys to just stay. We're going to do something different. I want us to make an altar, to find a spot, you know, and it can be your chair, it can be the front, it can be the altars, it can be the stairs. It doesn't really matter where it is, because I just want you to find a place, because I need to ask you a few questions. And I'm going to ask you, whenever we get ready to go into altar, that you just dwell, that you give God some time. That's what Asa did. He took time, and he evaluated. So here's what I have to ask you. What do you want? Peace in your home? A God-fearing family? A ministry? A purpose? Renewed vision of the church? Are you happy with what is happening under your umbrella of leadership? Whatever that may be, whatever position you're in. Are you unhappy with something in someone else's life? Probably most of us could say, yes, I don't like the way they're doing that. I don't like what's happening in their life, in their devotion, in their area. We probably could say yes, yes, yes to all of these because we're human. We're all quick to see changes that need to happen and see things that other people need to do, but imagine a young Asa with me for just a second, okay? Imagine a young Asa, and he's living in this house where evil is taking place continuously. His father's not a godly man. And meanwhile, he has one job as a future king. Boy, you better know your history. He has scribes reading the history books to him. He has to read them himself. He probably had to even do some transcribing of it. It's just the practice of the day, right? And as he's reading, he's going, that doesn't make much sense. Wait, I don't see that idol in God's word. I never read where God said build an Asherah pole and worship him. I don't see this. So imagine a young Asa, and he's here, and he's frustrated, and he's just waiting. For some of you, that's where you're at. You're just waiting for your time, for your moment. You see where the idols are. And Asa's here, and he's flipping through the scripture, and he's saying, I don't see it. The church isn't giving money where it needs to go, and the people aren't worshiping who and where they need to worship. Things aren't working the way that it should be. And so the day comes where Asa gets to be king. And instead of saying, I've got a word for you, he takes a step back. And he says, let me clean house. And he gets out all his idols. And then he starts to cleanse the church. He didn't go straight to commanding his brothers and sisters in what they needed to do that was right. Asa started at home. He said, I'm going to break some generational idols in my life, the ones my grandma and grandpa put up. And this is where it starts. Miss Trina, if you'll come, we're going to get ready to close. So tonight I'm going to ask you to dwell. I told you I was going to ask you to do that. Together, to observe. Not your neighbor's idols, but your own house. What do you have in the groves? Where's your time, your money, your focus? Whatever your priority meter is, the thing that you use in your own life to determine where your priorities are, I feel like it's probably a little different for every person. Check that and see where that is, and that'll show you where you might need to clean out some idols in your own life. But it only happens when you come to God and you say, God, you've got to help me here. I can't do this one. Dwell on one thing. Once you've cleaned out your idols, ask God why. Why did you challenge me to get rid of that? What was the purpose? Because I'm going to be honest. I'm looking at a congregation. You showed up on a Sunday night, okay? You probably have made the big decision. I don't want to presume, but let's just say. So I'm going to say the idols in your life might not even be that big. It might be really small. So when you get up from the altar and you've given it to God, I want you to say, God, what was the purpose of that? Why did you have me give you that? Where am I going next? Dwell. Most of the problems we have with others can be ironed out whenever we start to work on ourselves and we clean out the idols in our own lives. I have a really dear friend. She's one of my best friends. And she and I did not get along at first. And later, when we became like the best of friends, we were like, how did we not get along? And she said, because we are exactly the same. The things I didn't like about you are the same things I don't like about myself, and the things you didn't like about me are the same things I don't like about myself, and you don't like about yourself. So a lot of times when we start to point, we should be pointing a little bit like finger guns with a couple of fingers pointed back at ourselves. Judah had peace after that, and they maintained peace. They went into a building project that was highly successful. They beat enemies during this time, but it all started with cleaning out the idols. So why am I asking you to pray? Well, number one, that's a really good option, right? But that's how Asa got started. See, Asa's in this battle, right? I told you we'd get to that later. Asa's in this battle, and he's facing an enemy, and he looks out and he sees an enemy, and he goes, I know exactly what to do about this. And this is what he says. In 2 Chronicles 14 and 11, it says, and Asa cried unto the Lord his God and said, Lord, it is nothing with thee to help, whether with many or with them that have no power. Help us, O Lord, our God, for we rest on thee. And in thy name we go against this multitude. O Lord, thou art our God. Let not man prevail. God, you, I gotta have you. And then after they won the battle, they're all heading out and they're on their way home, and that's when the man of God approaches Asa and he says, Asa, won't you take a look at Israel? They don't have a God right now. Do you want to know why? Because they can't follow God's commandments. You need to clean house. And that was the start. It didn't start with the cleaning. I know you're tired, maybe not physically, but spiritually, some of you. You're really trying, but it may take 10, that's fine too. Because here's what we need to do as individuals. I need you to press in. As tired and weary as you are, and I need you to make an altar. And at that altar, you need to clean house. Get rid of the idols. You're not going forward. Your umbrella is not going to expand. God cannot use us if we continue to let idols in our lives. So come and make an altar and get the idols out. And then tomorrow morning, or maybe even tonight, when you get up and you start your day, or you start your shift, or you start whatever's next, you've got to make it a reality. It doesn't end here. It starts here, but it doesn't end here. It would have been great for Asa to say, it would have been easy for him to say, that is a great word, Azariah. I hear what you are saying. I think that is powerful. Praise the Lord. Dwell in prayer until you get the idols out, and then I want you to work every day to make sure they stay out. Starts with you. Join me at the altar.